This is Dale Maharaj. In today's show, I'm going to talk about three really cool hobo pictures that are in our new book, Someplace Like America. There's Hobo Wave, Ken Sleeps, and Denver Wide. Michael Williamson is not talking with me on this video. One of the reasons is I'm going to brag on him a little bit today. Actually, a lot. These photographs are extremely powerful hobo pictures, and I'm going to tell the stories behind them, how they were made, and give you some context surrounding the characters in them. We were in the Western Pacific Yard in Sacramento on our very first hobo trip in April of 1982. This southbound train was coming through, and what you see here are Michael's photographs, frame by frame, of how he took this series of pictures. The train was going pretty fast for a yard. It was, I would say it was 20 or 25 miles an hour. So Michael got his camera and he got the picture of this hobo. And then, boom, this car materialized full of guys. Michael didn't have very much time to react. And this is a testament to his ability to take photos under pressure and capture the moment. I vividly remember the motor drive going, boom, 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 as he got these next frames of the guys going by. Now, this is full frame. This is a testament to Michael's photographic abilities. He had a perfect composition. His horizon was exactly dead on. The one thing that makes this photograph really work, and this part is an accident, is in the background, there's another train they call piggybacks. These where they carry tractor trailer rigs on these flat cars. They're called piggybacks or pigs by hobos. And there's a pig in the background with a semi-tractor trailer on it, which gives it that white, crisp background. It's almost like de facto photo backdrop for Michael. It's among Michael's top hobo photos, and it was taken the very first hobo trip. Ken Sleeps is another one of Michael's iconic photographs. It was taken later in 1982 when we traveled for Life magazine on assignment to document the new jobless. This man is Ken. We met him and his buddy, whose name I can't remember now, up in Salt Lake City in the Roper Yards in the Denver Rio Grande in Western. It was late that evening, so Michael didn't take very many pictures. This is the first image Michael took of Ken. We were en route to Grand Junction, Colorado. Ken had lost his job and had just hit the rails recently. He buddied up with this other fella, and he was going to go to Denver to look for work. We woke up in Grand Junction, Colorado. Our train got broken up. We were waiting for a new train that would take us over the Rockies to Denver. They had instant coffee, and they made themselves some coffee. Now, I don't remember the story behind Ken's buddy. Nice guy. He was more of an old-time hobo, where Ken was brand new. He'd only been in the rails for, I think, a couple of weeks, as I remember. Ken was lost. He didn't want to be out there. He was like an innocent out in this tough, tough hobo world. We finally caught a freight, a Denver Rail Grand and Western. We caught a piggyback, of course, a pig. Michael really worked this image. Many, many more pictures that I'm showing here. Like others of this show, these images are taken from Michael's contact sheets. I couldn't find his negatives. He didn't have all these outtake pictures printed, so I blew up the contact sheet images and photoshopped them. And a lot of them really blown out, and I just didn't put them in here. But Michael loved this picture of Ken nestled in the crook of the steel as this train lumbered up over the Rockies. Michael actually had to hang out over space to get this picture. He's hanging out by one hand, getting this image, trying to get as much of the ground and river in the image as possible. Very hard shot to get, actually. So we got higher and higher in the Rockies, and suddenly the train stopped. And the trains often side for westbounds, eastbounds. They still had cabooses in those days. They called them crummy. We called them crummies. And the guy in the crummy came up, railroad worker, and he said, they didn't put enough power on the train in Grand Junction to get us over the top. We have too much tonnage. Basically, the engine stalled. We're waiting for some more engines. And he shook his head, and he says, hell of a way to run a railroad. I think he bumped some coffee off of us, actually. We gave him a little bit of instant coffee. And we waited a long time for that power. So Michael took a lot of images of the fire and Ken lighting up a cigarette and taking a smoke. And then finally, we get underway. This picture was taken at dusk, and then we hit the Moffett Tunnel. It's 6 miles long. It's a famous railroad tunnel. It was built in the 1920s. Michael took this series of images showing what it's like to be in this black tube. It's sort of like Space Mountain at Disneyland with diesel fumes choking you. I guess back in the old days of steam trains, some hobos would die if they were too close to the steam train. Hobos don't die today, but man, we had diesel in our lungs for hours afterwards. We finally cleared the tunnel, came down into Denver. And the next morning, this is Ken washing up. He wants to go. He's eager to look for work. And so I was going to guard the packs, and Michael, Ken's buddy, and Ken were going to go into town and look for jobs. One thing that John Lowengard, the photo editor at Life magazine, had implored Michael to do in his very stern but I see later loving way, show me dignity. Show me somebody trying to maintain. And that's why these pictures of Ken washing are very important, because he really wants to look good, and it's hard. I mean, he doesn't look much different after he washes than before, but I think psychologically I'm sure he felt better. Ken looks for work, and to no avail. There's these temporary labor agencies, and they just got hundreds of guys, you know, willing to work for them. He doesn't have much of a chance, but he fills out an application anyway. Now, while they're gone, I'm guarding the packs on the river, on the South Platte River. I saw this guy sniffing glue. Eventually, he starts coming at me. He's got a wire in his hand, and he's tensing the wire, and he starts to attack me. He's trying to strangle me with the wire. So he was out of it. I could have just knocked him out, but I didn't want to hurt him if I didn't have to. If he had a gun, I'd have just pummeled him, but I jumped up on a concrete pier for a bridge, and I had the rock, and he kept coming. He started coming up after me, and I'm screaming, get the fuck out of here, get the fuck out of here. Just then I hear Michael and the guys above, what's wrong, what's wrong? And the guy looks up, and he finally gets scared, and he runs away. After Ken and his buddy moved on, Michael and I slept in an abandoned box car in the Denver and Rio Grande Western Yard. This is some items left behind by the former occupants. We hung out a few days in Denver. We ended up meeting a few other hobos, a guy named Ron Martin. You saw him in an earlier show, pictured. We had a dinner out of a tackle box. And right by us was this giant building. It looked like it was some kind of flour milling operation. It looked abandoned, but on closer inspection, we heard some noise inside, and a piece of it was being used by some business for storage, but the upper levels were... Windows were smashed out. There were pigeons coming in and out. It looked pretty abandoned, but there was no way to get in. And the reason Michael wanted to get in was he had an idea for a photograph. Wasn't sure if it would work, so we found an outside pipe. We climbed it and shimmied up the pipe to a level. And I'll never forget. We took no pictures of this, but there was a ledge we had to walk on for about 10 feet to go in one of the windows, and it was hairy. But we were motivated. I don't know why. We just kind of did it. We got into the building, went up several floors. It was a very spooky place, and came to this window and saw this view. Like, my gosh, this is a $1 million view. So Michael snapped a few pictures, including one of me in my bandana. And we went down to the first floor, and we unlatched a bolt and went out a door. We didn't have to go back down the pipe. And we left it unlatched, hoping it would stay open until that night. So come night, I sat with the guys, and Michael went into the building and climbed that spooky stairwell to the window and took an image that is surely his best hobo picture. Denver Wide, he calls it. Postscript, I was in Denver in 2010 for a writer's conference, and I walked down to the South Platte River waterfront and wanted to see this old building. Unfortunately, did not have my camera, so there's no images, but it's now called the Flour Mill Lofts. Units sell between $500,000 and $2 million in it. It indeed was $1 million views. But I'll never forget that view and what that building was like back in 1982.